Hi, hello everyone. How are you all? Doing good? Yes. So, as you know, Ikshvaku's period has started from yesterday. So today is our day to continuing Ikshvaku's. Today is a very interesting chapter we are going to study about Ikshvaku's, which is the hierarchical dynasty. How was the hierarchy? Who were the kings and who came after who? The hierarchy we are going to look into. Yeah, let me maximize and show you this picture. What is it about? Yeah, this is Rajsuyagna from Mahabharata. Okay, so in this picture, you'll be seeing various activities which happens when you perform a Rajsuyagna. You see here the Raja performing the rituals along with the Pandit. And you see here few other activities are going on. Here they are giving dan. Dan mean alms. They are giving alms to the Brahmins or Purohit during that time, right? Here you see Draupadi is again taking blessings and feeding the Brahmins. And you see here few other activities are going on. Karna is also involved in this. So like this various activities are happening in Rajsuyagna. Why I am showing all these activities? Because all these activities were also performed by Ikshvakus. Okay, let me clear this off. And get back to normal. So with this, what I want to tell you is Rajsuya Yagna is not an easy yagna. It is not at all an easy sacrifice that you perform, because with this sacrifice you have to be universally accepted by the kings, saying that okay, you can rule and few others will be under you. Okay, so that's why Rajsuya Yagna is given very very importance in our history. Ikshvakus, they have performed this yagna, meaning that they have overcome Shatavahanas. After Shatavahanas, Ikshvakus were accepted by many of the small kingdoms, right? So how did they do this, right? So their expansion of the territory or the kingdom could only be possible if they maintain good relationships. These days waging war is not at all considered to be a good option. If you're performing good relationship, maintaining good relationships, then it can move forward, right? So now we will see how they have maintained that good relationship amongst their nearby kingdoms. Okay, now I'm going to show you the hierarchy of Ikshvakus. Okay, here is the hierarchy of Ikshvakus. Like I said, we know about four kings, but other three kings we don't know about them much. Okay, so there is a total of seven kings, out of which we are going to talk about only four kings. Okay, starting with Vashishtaputra Santamula one. Vashishtaputra Santamula one, he is also called to be the founder of Ikshvakus. Yeah, who is it? Vashishtaputra Santamula one. And then his wife is Mathari. Mathari is again a Brahmin daughter. And Vashishtaputra Santamula's sisters were Shantishri and Haumyashri. Both the sisters, they actually went into the direction of Buddhism. They were very much involved in construction of viharas and chaityas. When we are talking about Buddhism, you always try to build temples for Buddhist people. So those are nothing but the viharas and chaityas. Viharas are nothing but the residential areas, and the chaityas are the Buddhist temples. Okay, this seen in our Shatavahanas and many other dynasties after that. Okay, and so they, who Shantishri and Haumyashri, they were actively involved in Buddhism. Mathari, she was a Brahmin lady. So with this, we got an idea that what could be the religion during that time, meaning that a combination of Hinduism and Buddhism, you can say, right? So slowly, slowly, Buddhism was going and Hinduism was taking its place. Okay, and then their child was Mathari Putra Veerapurusha Datta. Now Mathari Putra Veerapurusha Datta, he actually married four people. Three are the daughters of his aunt. Okay, three are the daughters of his aunt, and one is the daughter of Rudrasena too. We'll look into the Rudrasena too part also. Let's talk about Shantishri and Hermyashri daughters. So Shantishri had a daughter whose name is not known, and Hermyashri had two daughters, who is Vapishri and Shastishri. How to remember these names, guys? We have to remember a couple of names, okay? Because Ikshvaku dynasty is very little, very few kings are there, and one of those kings you have to remember, Vashishta Putra Santamala, because he is the founder. And next, talking about Shantishri and Hermyashri, because they have given most contribution in their Buddhism construction of the viharas and the stupas. And Shri Shri, everywhere Shri is coming. So that's how you can remember for Ikshvakus. Whenever you see a Shri, then that could be a possible answer to your question. Okay, and so Mathari Putra Veerapurusha Datta, he actually bonded or he married his Menatta's daughter. You know, right? Menatta meaning your paternal aunt. Okay, so he married three people from paternal family. And then Rudradhara Bhattarika. He married Rudradhara Bhattarika. She was the daughter of Rudrasena too. This Rudrasena too, he is a Saka ruler. We have talked about Saka rulers. Saka tribe is a foreign tribe, okay? So Rudrasena too is a Saka ruler, which means he is not a native king. He is a foreign tribe settled in the Indian region, okay? So Rudradhara Bhattarika, he married. After that, he started to maintain good relation with the Sakas as well. Okay. After this, Mathari Putra Veerapurusha Datta's son is Vashishta Putra Ehubala Santamula. He is the one to be remembered, guys. He is important. Why, I'll tell you. Because he is the first Ikshvaku king to build temples for Hindus. That's why he has to be remembered. Aili Shri, his minister, he has constructed a temple at Nagarjunakonda. So that is one of the very famous temples. That's why the construction of temple actually started from that period, right? And now Kondapali Shri, she was the daughter of Mathari Purusha Datta. Now you see how I am showing the chronology to you. I say that these two, right, they are connected to Mathari Putra Veerapurusha Datta, which means they are the later generation, next generation, Vashishta Putra Ebala Santamala and Kondapali Shri. They are the later generation. Now how are they related? One is in square bracket. Square bracket meaning, I told, it is a boy, and in normal brackets it is the girl, and if they are connected with the link, then it becomes a brother sister relation. Yeah, so they are brother sisters. Now what is the next generation after Ehubala Santamula? Next generation, that is the son of Vashishta Putra Ehubala Santamula, is Rudra Purusha Santamula. Santamula, you have to remember, because this follows for the Ikshvaku hierarchy. Veerapurusha Datta is exceptional, and how you can remember Veerapurusha Datta is Mathari Putra. Mathari is the wife of Vashishta Putra Santamula. Okay, that's how we can remember these four kings. Four kings are very, 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 very important, and they try to maintain relationships by getting married. At that time, you can clearly see marriage is nothing but politics. So the same thing, it was followed by many of the kings. They used to consider marriage as a political relationship for their growth, or the growth of the kingdom, right? So this is the normal diagrammatical hierarchy. Take a screenshot if needed. Then yeah, after this we are going to move to the next slide and talk about Vashishthaputra Santamulavan. Talking about Vashishthaputra Santamula, just see his time period, guys. What is the time period of Vashishthaputra Vipala Santamula? Vashishthaputra Santamula, it is 180 to 193 AD. So almost around 13 years he has ruled. And this Vashishthaputra Santamula, he is considered to be the founder of Ikshvakus. It's not Shatavahanas, guys. It is Ikshvaku. Please correct this. Ikshvakus. Okay, he is the founder of Ikshvaku dynasty. Now, how did he get the name that he is the founder of Ikshvaku dynasty? We are going to look into, because we have found sources, though little sources, but the evidence was so strong in deriving whatever the situation could have been at that period, right? So it was immensely helpful. Okay, so the inscription, the first inscription which we found was at Fanigiri. At Fanigiri, few excavations have taken place. Excavation meaning the archaeological department, they went there and they have dug things. So in that digging process, they found few inscriptions. Like I said, inscriptions could be anything, the plates on which you write something, or the books, or anything which belongs to their period, right? In the written format could be treated as a inscription. So one such inscription was found which was not in a good position. It was cracked and all, and these inscriptional plates were found, and this just had 10 lines of information. With that 10 lines itself, we got to know a lot of stuff about Ikshvakus, meaning that what could have been the king name of that time, what is his son name, who married whom, right? So those things was completely defined in this inscription in 10 lines. In just 10 lines it was mentioned. So what did the inscription talk about? Is first is the name Santamula. You see the Santamula hierarchy, right? This Santamula he talked about, and then he said that he, Vashishthaputra Santamula, had the son Mathariputra Veerapurushadatta. This Veerapurushadatta, he married his own father's sister's daughters. All the daughters he married. Okay, this information was got from where? It was Fanigiri. Where is Fanigiri, guys? It is in Nalgonda, right? I'm not showing you the maps because I have already shown this in my earlier dynasties. So this is the information which found. And apart from this, we also found names saying Mahatalwara, Kshantamula Maharaja, Mahatalwara Rasa. Okay, these were the names which we found. So what the first thing we are saying, Mahatalwara. You see Mahatalwara. What does Mahatalwara mean? Yeah, it's a position given to a person. When I'm saying he is the president of India, meaning that president is a position, right? Likewise, Mahatalwara is a position. Now, what does Mahatalwara actually mean? Is Mahatalwara means they are the subordinate rulers, meaning they report to someone. Now, who could it be? It is definitely Shatavahanas, because Shatavahanas were top ruling dynasty at that time. After Shatavahanas only Ikshvaku, they have gained their place. So what could have happened is, historians, what the thought is, definitely Shatavahanas were ruling until some time, right? So after Shatavahanas, Yajnashri period started. It was the last great king, and after Yajnashri Shatakarni, it was three kings, right? And the last king was Pulamavithri. So during Pulamavithri, the things might not have gone pretty well between them. At that time, Vashishthaputra Santamula, he took that as an opportunity and he declared independence, and that's how it became independent from Shatavahanas. So the position given to them by Shatavahanas was Mahatalwara. So now we understood that okay, they were the subordinate rulers of Shatavarnas, and after Shatavarnas' declination, they declared independence. So this was the information provided by the Fanigiri inscription. This was the second part. Now, what is the other information that we got? The other information was, see, during Shatavarna's time, Buddhism was famous, right? Because the ladies of that time, they were involved in making Viharas and Chaityas. So people were crazy about Buddhism. They wanted Buddhism to be implemented by any way, any means, any format, right? So Vashishta Putra Santamula, he actually took that as an opportunity and he started to construct the Buddhist Viharas and Chaityas, who Santi Shri and Hermia Shri, they involved completely in making the Buddhist temples and the Chaityas Viharas for Buddhist people. Okay, now Santi Shri, you see, Santi Shri is married to Skanda Shri. I did not talk earlier about Skanda Shri. Let me quickly tell you, because now that Skanda Shri has come here. So Shanti Shri was married to Skanda Shri. Okay, who is Skanda Shri now? Actually, he belongs to a different dynasty. He actually belongs to Pugias, right? Pugias was a small dynasty at that time. You see, Ikshvakus, they have to maintain good relationships. So all whatever small dynasties are there, he tried to maintain relationships by marriage. So this Skanda Shri was belonging to one such small dynasty, which is Pugia. Okay, Pugia is a dynasty of that time. Now moving forward, so what did the third point we got from the inscription is, Shanti Shri and Hermia Shri, they were completely involved in making Buddhist Viharas and Stupas and also the Chaityas. Okay, so this was the next point. The other few other things what we got to know is, there were words like Kshantamula Maharaja and Mahatalvarasa. So these were few other words by the inscription shown. What is it? Mahatalvarasa and Kshantamula Maharaja. Anyways, whatever happened has happened. Now he declared independence with Shatavarnas. I told you, right? Pulamavi 3, he took it as an opportunity. Now he declared independence. After that, he has to declare himself as the emperor also, right? This he performed by doing Ashwamedha Yajna. Ashwamedha Yaga is nothing but you are killing or the sacrifice of Ashwa. Ashwa is elephant, okay? So that is Ashwamedha. And also apart from this, it was Rajasuya and Vajpayee Yajna also. Now Rajasuya Yajna, I have told you, this is the picture of Rajasuya Yajna. What happens in Rajasuya Yajna? You declare yourself as the king of the kings, or you move from Raja to a Samrat. So that position you get when you are claiming yourself as a Chakravarti or Samrat, right? So it is a higher position than king. So that is not so easy. So this is nothing but Rajasuya Yajna, which he performed successfully. And talking about Vajpayee, you offer few animals as a sacrifice. Apart from this, you also add the juice of leaves called Surma. I told you about Vajpayee Yajna in my earlier classes also. Now also I am repeating, it is Soma leaves. So Soma leaves is considered to be very pure, very spiritual of those days. So without Soma leaves juice, Yaga is considered to be incomplete, right? So that Vajpayee Yaga also he performed successfully. Apart from this, see, he has also was involved in donation. He worked for the upliftment of agriculture also. He wanted the agriculture side also to be developed. For that reason, he donated a lot of cows, right? And it was lakhs and lakhs of cows he donated, and he used to give gold to the Brahmins. So the donation was seen very much by Vashishta Putra Santamula. which is why he also got the title Mahadhanapati, right? So this was the complete history of Vashishthaputra Santamula. Let's see the hierarchy of Vashishthaputra Santamula once. So you see, Vashishthaputra Santamula's wife is Mathari, who is a Brahmin lady. He had two sisters, Santishri and Hermyashri, who were actively participating in making Buddhist temples, Chaityas, Viharas, right? And Shantishri is married to Skandashri. He is from Pugia family. And Skandashri was also working as Dandanayaka. The word Dandanayaka, what do you mean by that? Dandanayaka. Danda is meaning giving punishment, right? Nayak meaning the leader. So one who has the power to give punishment. It could be the Chief Justice of India's position, right? So that position was given to Skandashri. He was in that position and he belonged to the Pugia family. And then Hermyashri, Vashishthaputra Santamula's son, Mathari Putra Veera Purushadatta, he married three of the daughters of his paternal aunt, right? So that is Bhavishri, Shashtishri, one is unknown, and the other is Rudradhara Bhattarika, who is the daughter of Rudrasena too. Okay, now we are going to look into Mathari Putra Veera Purushadatta. We have already looked a lot about Mathari Putra Veera Purushadatta. First thing, he is the son of Vashishthaputra Santamula I, and we got many inscriptions about him, and the sources which we saw and the inscriptions were Amravati, Jaggayapeta, Nagarjunakonda and Bodhishri. These are the inscriptions. You can remember Nagarjunakonda very easily because this is the place they have been actually staying. Okay, and then Jaggayapeta inscription we have been talking from day one of Ikshvaku. And then Amravati and Bodhishri is new. Amravati you can remember because it is quite close to Nagarjunakonda, and yes, Bodhishri you can remember by the name like Shri Shri, right? The women of those period, it was always Shri Shri, meaning that you see this Santi Shri, Skanda Shri, Hermia Shri, Shashti Shri. So these are all Shri Shri. So like that you remember. It's a way to memorizing things, right? So what are we seeing is these are the inscriptions from which we got information about Mathari Putra Veera Purushadatta. So how did he maintain or how did he run the kingdom? Main thing is by performing marriage relationships. Always marriage, marriage, marriage. And he is trying to establish good bond and he is trying to rule the kingdom. That's how it is. And not only just that, he also got his daughter Kondabala Shri married to one of the kings from Shatavahana dynasty. Actually, Shatavahana dynasty is really huge, guys. So if I'm telling dynasty, then it also has a branch. So that branch, you term it as a family, okay? Kondabali Shri, who got married to this Shatavahana ruler, was actually belonging to the Chutu family. So Chutu family king, his name is not known though, but the area which he was ruling was today's Karnataka region. So this, the region was called as Vanvasa or Vanvasi, which is in Karnataka. So the normally the way he carry forward it is through the matrimonial alliances only. He actually tried to maintain good relationships. Yep, this is the story of Mathari Putra Veera Purushadatta. And coming to religion, he actually practiced Buddhism, meaning that see, Ikshvaku kings, they don't much get into religional stuff, all right? They always had main concentration of expansion of the kingdom and maintain good relationship with the nearby territories. And the religion part was mostly the part of women of those period, meaning so this could be your Shantishri, Bodhishri, Rudradhara Bhattarika, or the women of those time, the queens of those time. They have actively given donations, they have made the construction for a number of Buddhist monuments. All these things was women territory. So this is the story of Mathari Putra Veerapurushadatta. Now talking about Ahubala Santamala, Ahubala Santamala, you have to remember him because he is the first king who made the contribution for the first construction of Hindu temple in Nagarjunakonda. The prime minister of Ahubala Santamala is very, very well known, that is Elish. He constructed one of the Hindu temples, Elishri, Elishwaram, under his name only. And then another Hindu temple he constructed, which is Swarna Devalaya. Where is this located? This is at Nagarjunakonda. You see, many, many temples, Pushpadhara temple, Nandikeshwara temple, Kartikeya temple, Ashtabhuja temple, Navagraha temple, all these temples were built by Ikshvakus. So these temple building timings, it started from Ahubala Santamala. And he is considered to be the third and last independent ruler of Ikshvakus. The fourth ruler, you know, the declination started. Okay, the declination of the dynasty started. So third and last independent ruler was Ahubala Santamala. And the inscription is again the Nagarjunakonda, which was found around 1954 to 61 AD. You don't have to remember the year, but it was written in Prakrit language. So at that time, Sanskrit was not in vogue and Prakrit was only famous at that time. And the religion which was followed was Buddhism. Okay? Now you see, Ahubala Santamala, he started construction of temples. So does it mean that the temple Hinduism started to take place from that time, or Buddhism still continued? What do you think? What could have happened at that time? Actually, what happened was, with temples Hinduism it started to grow, and with the end of Ikshvakus, actually Buddhism also started to decline. It also did not gain much importance, but Ahubala Santamala, he did much whatever he could have been possible by him. So the religion followed during that time was also Buddhism. He constructed many chaityas, viharas, and the capital being Vijayapuri, he made viharas and chaityas in the capital city only. So there have been many donations done by him, and the language used at that time was Prakrit language. Okay, this was the story of Ahubala Santamala. Main important thing is, temple started from Ahubala Santamala's period. And for how many years did he rule? You see, it is almost for 24 years, right? 24 years it is. The next ruler which we are going to look into, he is the last ruler, the fourth and the last ruler. He is Rudrapurushadatta. So what is the timeline of Rudrapurushadatta? It is 237 to 248 AD, how many are around 11 years. So in these 11 years, Rudrapurushadatta, he couldn't do much for Ikshvakus. The declination started to take place, and there was a Pallava king called Simhavarma. He had an eye on the regions ruled by Rudrapurushadatta or the Ikshvakus. So he was just waiting for a chance when Rudrapurushadatta is going to die, or whenever he is going to fall weak, I will go and just take his kingdom from him. So this nature was with Simhavarma. He is a Pallava king. You see, Pallava, Cholas, they are all Karnataka, Tamilians, all these people, okay? They don't have much importance in Telangana history, but yes, when they are thinking of occupying our kingdoms, their role come into picture, okay? So Simhavarma of that nature, he was eyeing on Ikshvaku dynasty or Ikshvaku's kingdom. There was an inscription called Maidavolu inscription. As per this inscription, what it actually said, that Simhavarma, see, he wanted the kingdoms, so definitely he has to come to Rudrapurushadatta. So once he came to Rudrapurushadatta's kingdoms, the people in their kingdom, they actually were not in a good position. The financial position was not going well. People were not happy. There was a lot of confusion happening in their kingdom. So after Simhavarma, Shivaskanda Varma, he has come and he has taken the entire Ikshvaku kingdom under his control. And with this, Mahakshatrapas, they became weak. Actually, Mahakshatrapas, they were having good relationship with Ikshvakus. So with the coming of Shivaskanda, they actually fell weak, and then Brihadpalanayas, they also revolted. So these are the enemy kingdoms and these are the neighboring kingdoms. So if you ask me who are these Brihadpalanayas and who are Mahakshatrapas, see, Kshatrapas are nothing but, you see, Kshatrapa dynasty, we have already seen Rudradaman, right? He is a Saka ruler. So he is a Kshatrapa who was a friendly ruler of Ikshvakus. And Brihadpalanayas, they were also a dynasty who were ruling the north of Andhra region, that is near Machilipatnam side. They were ruling, okay, who? Brihadpalanayas. So they started to revolt, meaning that edur tirgabadadam antaru kada adi chesaru, who? Brihadpalanayas. And then Mahakshatrapas, they fell weak, and then they couldn't help much for stabilizing Ikshvakus. They couldn't maintain Ikshvaku kingdom intact. Okay, so finally it went to Shivaskanda Varma as per Maidaulu inscription. So this was the hierarchy of Ikshvakus. So yeah, whatever we have seen is in this one complete slide, you can summarize. Okay, so that's why this slide is very, 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 very important. This one slide completely picturizes your entire concept of Ikshvakus. Okay, I'm going to stop my lecture here. If you like my video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, like, share, and subscribe to my TSBSC preparation. Till then, happy reading. Khuda Hafiz. Goodbye. Take care. Alvida. Bye bye.